right? Good morning, everyone. If you're tuned into the live stream nice and early, fair play to you. We're just doing some technical tests just to check it's all running well. So we'll be starting at 11, and it won't be me up here. You'd be glad to hear.
Thank you. It's very chilly. Emma, just go in and disconnect my headphones from the. You might have to go into Bluetooth. If you just search for Bluetooth.
Can I say that's what I normally do, but I wasn't sure if that's what everyone else does.
I can hear you on the live stream. Oh, is that? Is that switched? Yeah, are you able to take it off?
I presume I'll get a little wave in a minute. Well, good morning, everyone, and you're very welcome to Grosvenor Road Baptist Church here this morning. And if you're joining us online, you're also very welcome as well. It's my first time back in the building since March, so I'm very glad to be here. I'm very glad to see all of you as well, from the eyes up anyway, at least. We are still all wearing the masks inside, and that's great. Thank you, everyone, for adhering to that. And I would ask you as well, actually, just after the service, once we go outside, just to remember maintaining that distance. Really easy to do inside. It's all been measured out here with the seats. And we would also ask that you keep your masks on outside too, because it's really easy just to stray into that inside the 2 meters, and then you don't have to worry about it. So I'll mention more on that later, but you're very, very welcome. Really great to see you. And I'm just going to open in prayer for us. Father, we thank you that you are our ever-present help. You know our every action, our every thought, before we even get out of bed in the morning. We pray that we would strive to live in your presence throughout our day and throughout our lives. Thank you for the rare opportunity for us to gather here this morning, something that we once took for granted. We are reminded, though, that none of this was a surprise to you. It is all in your plan, and we rest in you. We gather here and in our homes to praise and worship you and learn more about your will for us. We pray that you would calm our minds, focus our attention, and that we'll be encouraged and lifted by your Spirit through the work of your Son, Jesus. Hear our thanks this morning, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. John is going to be preaching to us this morning, again, continuing his work through the Psalms, Psalm 115, and the title is Prayers for Time of Isolation, is the series, and this morning's one is Answering Secular Jibes. I'm just going to open as well with reading Psalm 121, just to encourage us this morning before we sing. So if you have your own Bible with you, you can turn to Psalm 121. I'll just give you a minute to do that. And if you're at home, you probably have the advantage of it coming up on your screen, or maybe not. I don't want to second guess the busy people who are broadcasting this. So Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. At the moment, while we're meeting, we're not going to be singing together, but we do have a great singer and guitar player here with us this morning to help us along. So the words are going to be projected. So we would just ask that you would just reflect on the words as we're not singing for the time being, and we'll keep people updated on that just as things progress.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring some. nothing that's of worth that you bless your heart. I bring you more than a song, for the song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I bring you more than a song, for the song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it, when it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, when it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you, all about you, Jesus.
It's a great reminder there, those words. I think, you know, as we slowly come back to meet together, it's important not to rush into doing everything again. And I think maybe over the last few months, it's been a good time to stop and just reconsider how we do everything, and whether that's with our friends and our family and just how we go about our lives. But it's been a good opportunity, I think, for me and for different people I've spoken to, just or even our just relationship with God, how we converse with him, how we worship him, just a good way sometimes to have some things taken away, to stop and reconsider how we focus our worship on our Father. Just going to go through some notices now. I mentioned earlier just about wearing masks outside after the service. We're not going to hang around too much this morning. The good news is that there's a church picnic this morning in Palmerston Park, not too far from here. And if you're not familiar with where that is, Jonathan Shaw is not here in the building at the moment, but he will be waiting outside in the foreground just to lead the way to the park for us. If you've come prepared, great. Normally, we're all about, you know, if you've bought a punnet of grapes, share them around. If you've got extra food, share them around. It's great. We're asking you, if it's not already obvious, please don't share your food this morning. It seems counterintuitive to what we're about, but there's very obvious reasons for why we're not doing that. So just eat the food you've brought. Obviously, if you're within your kind of family circle or whatever, you're welcome to share within that. If you haven't come prepared, there's great cafes and everything on the way there. And the the upside of this, I suppose, is that they are super prepared for a takeaway. So as I was getting my coffee this morning, there are dozens and dozens of boxes of ready-made sandwiches and everything else. So another great opportunity to support the small businesses, I guess, in the community if you haven't brought your picnic food. It would be great to see you there. And if you're watching at home, you can run into the kitchen now, grab your slice pan and start buttering bread or whatever as we go through the next song or something, and meet us there in the park. We'd love to see you there. Again, just remember that 2 meter distance with your picnic blankets. So it's probably gonna look like a giant chessboard, but good just to keep these things going for now. Our prayer meeting is on again this coming Wednesday. Not this coming Wednesday, the following Wednesday. Sorry, I'm a bit early in the month yet. So Wednesday week, that first Wednesday of August. And again, it's been great just to see so many people taking part in that. So we would ask that you just continue to meet with us via Zoom for prayer meetings just for the time being. Oh yes, and with us this morning are Lucas and Juliana, and we happen to be meeting on their sixth wedding anniversary, so congratulations to you this morning. And I know that it's somebody else's seventh wedding anniversary this morning as well. Not that it's a competition, but they're maybe a bit more shy, and they're not here, so I won't make too much about that. But you're very, very welcome, and congratulations to you as well. So just going to focus for a moment just on our missionaries this week, and that's the Maidens down in lovely Kinsale, and the Davises up here in Dublin as well. So we're going to pray in just a moment, and you can pick up their prayer cards virtually, I guess, if you don't. We would normally have them in this stand here, but if you would like to hear from them, there is some information in the email that went out, and please do contact Valerie in the office if you want to be added to any of those lists. They'd love to hear from you and to stay in touch with you too. So we're just going to pray again now, so if you'd like to bow your heads. Father, we thank you for the great work that is going on with our missionaries that we support. Despite the different set of circumstances, they have found amazing ways to reach out in their own communities and have had great news of people joining them online that they may not have seen in person in a while. And there's just very encouraging stories of the great work that your Spirit is doing in their lives, the lives of the people joining the services as the Maidens and the Davises and other missionaries work to reach out and tell the good news of you, Father. Just pray for the Maidens in Kinsale, Father, as they lose some friends back to the United States. Just thank you for all the work that they have done there with them, and we pray that there will be real fruit from their ministry as they leave, and just that maybe more support would come for them as well. And for the Davises as well, Father, we really thank you for sustaining them through lockdown. They were out of their home for such a long time, and they have really just spoken of the great blessing that that time has been and how you have blessed them and taken care of them. And for their involvement in the clubs that they have been involved with online, we just thank you, Father, for your faithfulness to them. And we thank you for new opportunities that they're seeing in witnessing for you. Father, we just pray for wisdom for our government in planning for the future, and that is such a big and broad thing in our country right now, with a new government dealing with all the challenges we had before March and so many more now, and the new way that we have to go about our lives. We just pray that you would just give them great guidance in planning for forward, Lord, and we pray that they would just seek your wisdom in that. We pray that for those who've lost their jobs or who are furloughed or who are seeking work, Father, we just pray that through the government you would work in just getting the economy back to where it needs to be to provide work for people. We just, there's so much uncertainty in the future. We thank you that we can trust in you, Father. We thank you for our health workers who are so dedicated and so selfless, and everyone who's on the front line just daily going to work and serving everyone in the country, putting their own lives at risk. And we pray that the rest of us, Father, who aren't necessarily on the front line, but just that we would have a sensible reaction to the different measures that the government is being put in place. We just think of those who are in our congregation who can't be with us this morning, Father, that you would just bring them healing, just that you would give them deep rest. And for those, Father, who who are maybe just suffering in the short term, that you would give them a full recovery. And we think of Ed and the Neils, Father. We just pray for Miriam and Ed and the rest of the family, that you would just be with them as they work through this. And we pray that you would just give us great patience, all of us, as we wait on you, Father. We thank you that you are a loving Father who is in control, who is all-knowing and merciful. You are our help, and we look to you for rescue. Help us to trust in you for everything, Father, and just to be in conversation with you throughout our lives, Father, just that we would keep the channels of communication open, that we wouldn't let worry close those off, and that we would just seek true rest and restoration in you. Just give us the desire, Father, to parent the way that you parent us, with endless patience, delighting in our children and finding joy in the hard times, and also to be obedient children ourselves, seeking to become more like your Son, Jesus, who is our brother through your great work. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Candy's going to come up to us now and read Psalm 95, verses 1 to 6, if you'd like to turn to that. Thank you.
Good morning. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depth of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker.
And with that invitation to sing from the psalm, we're going to sing again. We're not going to sing again, but we're going to reflect on the words. So if you'd just like to follow along with the words as they're projected.
Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. Come bow before him now with reverence and fear. In him no sin is found. We stand on holy ground. Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is he. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. He burns with holy fire, with splendor he is crowned. How awesome is the sight, our radiant King of light. is shining all around. Be still, for the power of the Lord is moving in this place. He comes to cleanse and heal, to minister His grace. No work too hard for Him. In faith receive from Him. Be still, for the power of the Lord is moving in this place. No work too hard for Him. In faith receive from Him. Be still, for the power of the Lord is moving in this place.
So John is going to come and speak with us now. I just spotted baby Sean there. It's my first time seeing baby Sean in person, and it will be for many of us, so it's great to see Maeve and Peter and Sean out this morning, so be sure to say hello to them after. And I just want to say a continued thanks to everyone who is involved in the background of this in terms of broadcasting. It really is a lot of work, and it's much easier for me to not have to prepare as many things, but there's so much more things going on in the background for those watching at home. So we thank you for your patience as things have evolved and changed since March in the different way that we're doing things. And so bear with us as we keep changing things. And thanks again to that team who's working on that. And thank you to John for coming and speaking with us this morning.
Thank you, Andrew, for your welcome. It's great to be with you again in Grosvenor. Could I invite you to turn, if you have a Bible, please, to Psalm 115. We have been thinking together of Psalms written in times of isolation, because so many of us are experiencing that isolation at the moment. And so we come today to Psalm 115. We're going to read just the first 9 verses. This is the word of God. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory, because of your love and faithfulness. Why do the nations say, where is their God? Our God is in heaven. He does whatever pleases him, but their idols are silver and gold, made by the hands of men. They have mouths but cannot speak, and eyes but cannot see, and ears but cannot hear, and noses but cannot smell, and hands but cannot feel, and feet but cannot walk, nor can they utter a sound with their throats. Those who make them will be like them, and so will all who trust in them. O people of God, O house of Israel, trust in the Lord, for he is their help and their shield. Let's take a moment to pray as we come to God's word. Father, one more time we pray that you would graciously send your Holy Spirit to be our teacher, so that we echo the prayer of the psalmist, Lord, open our eyes to see wonderful things in your word, for your name's sake. Amen. Where is their God? For, I suppose, about 1,500 years, Ireland has been part of what we call Christendom, a society based at least broadly on Christian values. But it was a society, I suppose, where the majority of people believed in God and went to church and had Christian weddings and Christian principles underlined our laws, and Sunday was a public day of rest and worship. But over the last 50 years or so, those foundations have been crumbling to the point where they are at collapse. We live in an Ireland today which prides itself in being a modern secular nation. The word secular means to run society without reference to God. Christian values have been shifted from the center to the margins and from the public realm to the private. Sunday has become the day for shopping and sport and leisure, and attendance at public worship is in sharp decline in almost every of the major denominations. For example, in the Roman Catholic Church, the number of active priests has plummeted by 50% in the last 25 years, and the Presbyterian Church in Ireland has lost over 30,000 families in the last 40 years or so. And so we have a generation of young people growing up in an Irish society which says effectively, if you believe in God, you keep it to yourself. We don't want him to interfere with us. Christendom is gone, and we are in what we call a post-Christian society. And while the gospel is advancing all over the world, according to secular research, there are at least 19 million new Christians added to the church every year, and the percentage of Christians in the world is higher than it's ever been. Yet here in the West, Christian churches are on the back foot. So I suppose we can sympathize, therefore, with the psalmist who wrote Psalm 115. He was one of many Jewish believers who was exiled in Babylon, cut off from the temple and Jerusalem, the city of God, the focal point of his faith. And worse still, the reports from Jerusalem were very distressing because the temple had been ransacked and the city walls brought down, and God had seemed to do nothing at all. And to add to his misery, the psalmist had to listen to the jibes of his pagan neighbors, for they had gods they could see and touch and feel, made from silver and gold, and they said, "Where is your God? He doesn't seem to be doing you much good at the moment." So the question asked then and today of Christian believers, where is their God? It might be a taunt, or for some people it might be a sincere question, but it deserves an answer. And notice how the psalmist answers the question. He does not point to a temple in Jerusalem, because he knew, as Solomon had prayed at the dedication of the temple, "O God, the heaven and the heaven and the heaven of heavens cannot contain you, far less this temple that I have built." So if not in sacred buildings, where does God dwell? Where can we meet with him? We need to turn to another temple. So let me suggest at least five places that we may meet with God. First of all, God meets with us in his world in creation. Notice how the psalmist puts it in verse 3. He is in the heavens, and he does on earth what he chooses. In other words, God is above and beyond his world, and he rules over absolutely everything. Not a square inch of the universe that he did not make and does not own. And that's a repeated theme in the Psalms. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, Psalm 24. The heavens declare the glory of God, Psalm 19. The sea is his and he made it, and his hands formed the dry land, Psalm 95 that Pansy just read. But I think particularly dramatic is Psalm 29. It begins with the words, "Ascribe to the Lord the glory due to his name." But what's the psalmist thinking of? Well, he goes on to describe a dramatic thunderstorm ripping through a forest, bringing down great trees in its wake. And this is what he says. He, God, strikes with flashes of lightning. He breaks the cedars in pieces. He twists the oak and strips the forest bare. And in his temple all cry glory. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. The whole of nature, the whole of creation is his temple. It, if you like, it's an outdoor theater of his power and his majesty and his beauty. And far from hiding from us, God's glory is pressing in all around us, and we must deliberately keep him at bay to avoid him. Some people foolishly suggest that science has made God redundant because it can now explain a little bit more of how God's universe works. But they forget two things. Number one, the founding fathers of modern science were nearly all Christians, and the reason that they were inspired to look for consistent laws in the universe was because they knew it was created by a rational God, and they expected to find order and not chaos. And secondly, they forget that science and the Bible give us two different but complementary descriptions of God's world. And perhaps a, A simple story might help. Here's a young girl walking along a beach beside a bay, and she suddenly sees a light flashing intermittently across the bay. And just above her in a nearby house, there's a physicist. And he too sees the same light and wonders what it is. It has not been a light he's seen before. So he switches on all of his instruments and he records the color, the intensity, the wavelength, the frequency, and more or less everything science can say about that light, and he prints it on his computer. The young girl down below knows very little about physics, but she has two advantages over the physicist. Number one, she's a girl guide, and she understands Morse code. And number two, it's Valentine's Day, and she knows that her boyfriend is across the bay, and he had promised at the set time to send her a message. And when she sees that light flashing, she blushes, because it says, I love you, I love you, I love you. Now, the scientist gave a perfectly accurate physical description of the light, but somehow he missed what was even more important, surely, what the girl guide had grasped, who was behind the light and the message it conveyed. Science can explore how God's world works, but we need to turn to the Bible to discover the why and the who behind it all. So we thank God for the benefits of science, but if we cannot survey God's world, the world of nature, and say with the psalmist, give to the Lord the glory due to his name, then we too have missed the most important thing. But the second place that we meet with God is not only in creation, but supremely in Christ, his Son. For the whole of the Old Testament pointed to that day when one would come to earth who was worthy of the title God with us. And those promises were fulfilled with the coming of Jesus. He said himself that he was the true temple. He was the true dwelling place of God on earth. And of course, he made the most outrageous claims that only a madman would have made if they were not true. He said he had come from God. Remember his words, I have come from the Father and I will go to the Father. He claimed to be one with God. He said, I and the Father are one. He claimed that he would reveal God the Father to us. He said, he who has seen me has seen the Father. And he claimed to do what only God can do, that is to forgive our sins. And furthermore, he claimed to be the way to God. He said, I am the way. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then he spoke of himself as the light of the world. And he went on to say that on the last day, we will be judged by one thing only. And that is our response to him. He said, this is the judgment. Light has come into the world, but people have loved the darkness rather than the light. And even at his death, he was in control, not those who put him on the cross, because he had gone there voluntarily to reconcile us to God through his death. So he made these most astonishing claims, but he not only made such claims, but he backed them up by his actions. Speaking to a storm with a voice of command, be quiet, and the storm obeyed. Healing the sick, even raising the dead, and just as he promised, raising himself from the dead on the third day. So that those who were closest to him had to say, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. And they were driven to the conclusion to confess like Peter, you are the Son of the living God. Like Thomas, my Lord and my God. Like Paul, our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. So if we want to meet with God, we meet God in Jesus. And if we claim this morning to be searching for God, then that's where we must start. And so God meets with us in his creation. He meets with us in Christ his Son. But thirdly, he meets with us in the church, and by that I don't mean the building, but the people of God. For just as God promised his Old Testament people, I will be your God and I will dwell among you, so he has promised to dwell among his New Testament people, the church, as a spirit-filled community. And notice how Paul writes it. Do you not know, he writes to the church, that you yourselves are God's temple, and his Spirit lives within you. Jesus himself had made that promise, where two or three gather in my name, there I will be in the midst. And so when you and I gather in praise and worship and prayer, and we humble ourselves before God's word, when we remember his death in bread and wine, he is there. And that's why we were able rightly to sing a moment ago, "Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here." I remember a family looked in one Sunday in a little church, which was not their tradition. It was just out of curiosity, but they kept coming. And when asked what it was that brought them back again, they said, "From the moment we came, we sensed the presence of God." God is with his people when they gather together. So James can say in his letter, "Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you." God meets with his people when they gather together in his presence. But fourthly, God meets with us in the individual believer. For God makes a most amazing promise to those who repent of their pride and their self-will and bow the knee to his Son and give him his rightful place in their lives. He promises that to all such, he will come by his Spirit to dwell in their lives and impart his nature to them. So again, Paul writes, this time to individual Christians, "Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and he lives in you?" So the Christian life is not so much about what we can do for God, but what God does for us, and then in us, and then through us. And so Paul can go on to say, "It is no longer just I who live, but Christ who lives in me." Where do we meet with God? Where is there God? God meets with us in his creation. He meets with us in his Son. He meets with us when his people gather together. And he meets with us in every individual believer. But fifthly and finally, God meets with us in the most unexpected places and ways. He's not limited to our thoughts or our plans. I'll always remember a young Chinese student who had come from Beijing, from an atheistic home. She had come to Ireland, actually she'd come to study music in Trinity, but prior to that she was studying English in another town, and she lived in digs, and she found, presumably it was a Gideon Bible in the drawer of her bedroom. She began to read the Bible for the very first time, and as she read one of the Gospels, she was powerfully drawn to the person of Christ. I'll always remember the first day she turned up at church. This is what she said. She said, "I have become a Jesus person. Can I join your Jesus family?" In her digs, she met with God, or God met with her through a book she found in a drawer. I think of another friend, now an evangelist, a godless workman standing at a funeral of a building on a building site, or rather standing at a funeral off a building site workmate who had been shot dead by terrorists. He had no thought of God in his thoughts at all. But he heard one short sentence read at the graveside, "God has put eternity in the heart." And that struck right home to him, and he realized that he was not ready to meet with God. I think of an English government minister, a member of the parliament, Jonathan Aiken, who ended up in prison for perjury. He lost his marriage, he lost his name, he lost his money, he lost his job. But there in prison, he began to attend a Bible study with some pretty rough fellow prisoners. Some of them were gangsters. And there God met with him and with them. Today, Jonathan Aiken is an Anglican minister. Or just a couple of weeks ago, a cynical headmaster with no time for God had heard that one of his former pupils had entered the ministry, a pupil, incidentally, to whom he'd given a hard time during his school years. So in the quietness of his own house, he never went to church, but he decided to listen in to his former pupil to one of the church services during this lockdown. And just a couple of weeks ago, the minister received a letter saying, "I have listened to the last four services from your church, and I realize that I am wrong and that you're right. And I've just made a decision that I should have made years ago." Even through the lockdown, God can meet with us. So where is God to be found? Well, he makes his presence known in the world that he has made, supremely in the Son that he sent, among his people gathered together, in each individual Christian, and in the most unexpected ways and places. The Bible puts it this way: he is not far from any one of us. Again, he says in his word, "If you seek me, you will find me, when you seek for me with all your heart." And he is to be found when we stop running from him and humbly choose to bow the knee and give him his rightful place as our great God and Savior. And it's a very serious choice. C.S. Lewis puts it this way: there are, at the end of the day, only two kinds of people. Those who bow the knee and say to God, "Your will be done." And those to whom God says in the end, "Have it your way. Your will be done." If we go on excluding him from our lives now, we will get our way in the end for eternity. Let's take a moment to pray. Lord, we thank you this morning that you are not far from us. We thank you that we see your glory all around us. We thank you for that beloved Son whom you sent into the world to reveal you to us and to reconcile us to you. And your word says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found." But Lord, we confess that we are by nature rebels, intent on going our own way. Give us the grace, Lord, today to heed your word, to bow the knee in faith and obedience, and to give to you the glory that is yours by right. We ask it for your name's sake. Amen. Andrew, a hand back to you.
Thank you so much, John. I'm just going to close in prayer, and just a reminder that the picnic is going to take place. We're going to roughly meet about 12:30 in Palmerston Park, and Jonathan Shaw will be in the foreground there to lead the way. So let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we thank you for meeting with us this morning, whether it's here or at home, and just throughout the week, just as John was reminding us of all the ways in which you are there to meet with us. We just need to be open to you and hear you, Father. We pray that you would have your Spirit just work in our hearts to keep that conversation going throughout our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.